on the occasion of the celebration of Guru Purnima 2019, I welcome all Atma Jyotis, Divine Light of the Self. Guru Purnima is in the month of July. Because of some circumstances, I'll have to travel. That's why we are celebrating Guru Purnima a bit earlier, to show a mark of respect to all the realized beings, spiritual masters, offering them our gratitude and praying them to show us the path, guide us in the path, show us light. Guru Purnima is called Vyasa Purnima. Okay? This festival, this celebration is done in honor of Sri Veda Vyasa Maharshi. Veda Vyasa Maharshi, in his honor, this festival was started about 5050 years back. So really Guru Purnima is called Vyasa Purnima in honor of Bhagavan Sri Veda Vyasa. Many of us are familiar of an incarnation of Sri Krishna about 5025 years back. The time Mahabharata war happened, Sri Krishna incarnated on the earth. Srimad Narayana, in the form of Vishnu, took the form of Sri Krishna to establish Dharma about 5025 years back. But what many of us don't know is that there are two incarnations during that period. Two incarnations of Bhagavan Vishnu. One incarnation of Sri Krishna and other incarnation is Bhagavan Veda Vyasa. The Lord incarnates for many reasons. When there are too many disturbances on the earth, to establish the order, dharma samsthapanarthaya cha, establishment of dharma, Srimad Narayana in the form of Sri Vishnu took incarnation as Sri Krishna to establish dharma. If you look back, that period is more than 5025 years back. Yes. So many disturbances have happened, so many wars have happened. But even till today, if you are speaking about some amount of dharma, some amount of culture in the society, it is due to the grace of Sri Veda Vyasa Maharshi. One incarnation of Krishna is for dharma, other incarnation is for Jnana Samsthapanarthaya. One is Dharma Samsthapana and other is Jnana. Establishment of law and order is one, and establishment of Jnana is the another incarnation. Okay, just by having a good law and order, the society will not progress. It requires the wisdom. So when the total turmoil happens in the society, huge amount of chaos happens in the society due to war, everything gets destroyed, including education system. Okay. Bhagavan incorporated in the form of Sri Veda Vyasa Maharshi. He took the avatara in the form of Veda Vyasa Maharshi to establish Jnana. So the two incarnations, one is Brahma Samsthapana Sri Krishna Paramatma, And Jnana Samsthapana is Vedavyasa Maharshi. Now what did Vedavyasa Maharshi do? Which is very significant. He established a system of education which lasts more than 5000 years. Okay? You can think of a syllabus, school syllabus, every 4 years it changes. Okay? If your own children, your school education system, syllabus changes very rapidly, the teachers have been trained. Okay? You think of a challenge of education. Now the spiritual education has to be given to the future generation. That was the challenge before Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. Now that education system has to be designed, a robust education system has to be designed for more than 5000 years. That's a bigger challenge. And Vedavyasa Maharshi in his wisdom saw so much of a turmoil which will come up in the country in the form of war, in the form of destruction, in the form of loss of education system. In spite of that, a system of education has to be established. That is the contribution of Vedavyasa Maharshi. You see, no other country in the world has gone through more than 1000 years of war. 1000 years of war and destruction. What has happened to our country? Please look at, if you go to North India, you will see. South India was a bit insulated. Everywhere, everything what was known as culture was destroyed. The total destruction. Education system was destroyed from the root. The Nalanda University, which was the greatest university in the world at that time, where 130 people from 130 countries studied, that was burnt down. And books in that university, to burn that books, it took only 6 months just to burn the books. The number of scholars in that university were killed. Whoever is the teaching education were killed, because these invaders knew to kill a society, you need to kill the system of education. Destroy the people who are giving education. Everything which is known as education was destroyed in those years. Then came the Britishers. So they destroyed education in a very subtle way. They created an education system which will become slave of the rulers at that time. Slowly, slowly, our education system was being controlled by the foreign forces. No country in the world has sustained this type of attack from external and internal enemies. But Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi established an education system which will last more than 5000 years, which will withstand the foreign attacks, which will withstand the killing of the teacher, withstand the all types of destruction which can happen. A robust education system. That contribution of Vedavyasa Maharshi has stood with us till today. You go to any of the Middle East countries, the culture there is completely destroyed. There is nowhere you see the original culture. Today here culture is sustained, I can't say the full form, but it has not died. That is the contribution of Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. To design an education system which will last over 5000 years, more than that. So this day, we respect Vedavyasa Maharshi for giving us a spiritual education system which is robust enough to withstand all kind of turbulences which happen in the society. We offer our respects, let's offer our respects to Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi and then understand his contribution to this system, and then we'll understand the system of education, spiritual education in India, how has it evolved, and what is the contribution of various masters in this whole process. Today is a day we are offering our respect to all those spiritual masters from the time immemorial who worked on a system of spiritual education which will benefit the future generation. So, on that occasion, let us respect Sri Veda Vyasa Maharshi. Vyasaya Vishnu Rupaya Vyasa Rupaya Vishnave Vyasaya Vyasa Rupaya Vishnave Namaha. So a tremendous amount of spiritual education system was established. That is actually about 5025 years back. Now, what is this spiritual education? Before Mahabharata war, the society, there was order in the society. Not a tremendous order, but a good order. The spiritual education was there for most of the people through system of Gurukula, system of education, spiritual education. People had the opportunity to get a spiritual education. Now, what is the spiritual education all about? What is the spiritual education we are speaking of? What is this spiritual education? What is the spirituality we speak of? Okay? This spiritual education is very simple and straightforward. You are not human. You are divine in human form. Remember your divinity. That's all is one line statement of spiritual education. Okay? We are not human beings. We are spiritual beings dreaming that we are human beings. This dream you have to come out. All our suffering, all our pain is because we are thinking that we are human and we are struggling for spirituality. It is not correct. We are spiritual beings having a dream that you are human beings. You don't have to struggle for spiritual upliftment. You have to struggle for coming out of the dream. Your spiritual nature is already there. So this is the only teaching of spirituality. Nothing else. It is not about religion. It is not about following certain customs, doing some puja. It is finally discovering your own nature as divine. That our ancestors called, by simple teaching called Tat Tvam Asi. You are that. What is it you are that? You are divine. You are God. This was a common knowledge. It's nothing special knowledge. Okay, over a period of time, the knowledge evaporated. With the advent of information technology and with the advent of societal conditioning, we forgot that. And we started living like animals. A human being started living like a life of animals, practically. The way to go back to your roots, to your essential nature, I am divine. That is the spiritual teaching. That's all. Simple. You are the Tattvamasi. You are God. It's very difficult for us to comprehend today because our mind has start in mind over a period of time. The society conditioning, cultural conditioning has put so much a burden on our system that we are not able to accept this easily. By understanding you are divine, what is the benefit you will get? Will I get a better job? Will I get a better mark? Better marks in my examination? At least will I get a more beautiful wife? So what is that I will get? You will get peace. Okay, you will get deep silence and peace. Peace that surpasseth, that's what is said in Bible. The peace which goes beyond all the pieces. The para shantim adhigachati. The supreme peace is what we get. Supreme bliss is what we get. And that can happen only when I understand that I am divine. I am one with God. No matter what you do, no matter whatever else you do, no matter whatever you gain in life, you cannot get that peace. That peace is because we have a deep feeling of separation from the existence. Separation from the existence causes the turmoil in us, the feeling of pain in us. When we are in the mother's womb, we were one with the mother and we were one with the totality. We didn't know I and mother are separate. I am separate from my mother, I didn't know. The womb was a place where everything was restful for us. The mind was stressful, stress-free, and I experienced a state of non-duality in existence in the womb of the mother. The moment I separated out from the mother, there's a tremendous amount of fear got generated, insecurity. I had to breathe first time. I had to cry for first time for food. The struggle for existential survival began. My mother was my existence. I didn't know it's my mother. And my mother and universal mother, universe all fused together for one for me, giving me peace, giving total rest in the mother's womb. Suddenly I am separated from that existence, and that caused a tremendous amount of suffering. That's called birth. And the child, during birth, you think that the mother only goes through the pain during birth? Mother goes through the pain, but child goes through existential crisis. I am separating from the existence. That crisis goes through. It's a very deep-rooted feeling of separation. Suddenly you are pulled out from your comfort zone, total comfort zone. And that becomes our drive for many things in life later. Okay? Now this existential separation, the pain of separating from the existence, cannot be healed by whatever you do. In the presence of your mother also, it can't get healed. It can get healed only when you re-experience that non-duality, which was your natural state in the mother's womb. And that is the spiritual journey, spiritual seeking. I have to experience that non-duality, sense of peace and silence, which I experienced in the womb of the mother. And the child is born, the child has some disturbance, food, then urination, then pain. But child is by and large blissful, the totally blissful. Okay? The bliss of the child is the bliss of the God. The divine bliss is there with the child. That's why we call the child as God. Child is God. Okay, that is actually an enlightened mind which comes with the child. So when you are born from your mother, how many people are born really? The three people born really. You don't know that. A triplet is born every time a child is born. From the body of the father and mother, a biological child is produced. A biological child is nothing but body which is made up of the food element from the parents. That's a biological child born from the parents. The consciousness of the child, it is divine. The body is animated by consciousness, which is not material nature. The consciousness is divine. That is called divine child. The biological child and the divine child are born. The divine child is not born. Divine child appeared, whereas the biological child born. The divine child just appeared in the biological child to see what's going on in this biological child. It just appears. The divine child in Vedantic language is called Chidabhasa, or reflected consciousness or manifest consciousness. And very soon another child is born. That's called society child. The society comes and starts programming this human child. Oh my son, oh my dear daughter, you are so beautiful and your name is so and so. So the naming process starts separation of the child from the existence. You start developing identity. The society child is called the mind. So we are a mixture of three: the consciousness, the body, and the mind. The consciousness is what we are. Without consciousness, body doesn't work, the mind doesn't work. Without body, mind doesn't work. Okay? So they are dependent on each other, but everything is dependent on the consciousness. That is divine consciousness in you and the divine child in you. Nothing happens to the divine child throughout our life. But the society child makes a lot of noise. Okay? Every bit of programming goes through, the society child goes through. Everything what you learned in your life is society change. Society is teaching you this, that, and it will tell you when you should be happy. Okay, you will be very happy when you are married. Okay, one society is there. Another society is saying, what happiness here? When you get divorced, you will be happy. Okay, so happiness is getting a car, and happiness is not getting a car. So this entire programming starts taking over for the this triplet: the body, the consciousness, and the mind. And out of this, mind becomes very powerful, because day-to-day, everyday programming goes on. And this triplet is hijacked by the mind. The divine child just, it doesn't have no ambitions. It's just silently witnessing this thing. It gets dragged in this whole process. So you are a child of three. Okay? First is, you are a child of biological parents, father and mother. This is good for your biodata, Aadhaar card. So everywhere that you have to produce identity, your biological parents' identity is to be produced. But you are a divine child. The consciousness is divine. The consciousness has come from the divine child, divine mother, divine father, Shiva and Shakti. The consciousness is always silent and peaceful. So you are actually the biological child from the biological parents, the divine child from the divine parents, and also you are a society child from many fathers and many mothers. Okay? So, you have many parents, but what are you originally? You are originally always the divine child. In the pull of the society child, in the tamasha, which is chaos which goes on in the society child, we are not able to recognize our divine nature. Okay? That alone can bring us peace. Nothing else can bring us peace. The society child can never be peaceful. If you get a car, a bigger car. A bigger car, another bigger one. And neighbor has a bigger car, neighbor has a bigger house. The society child is very disturbed. It can never be satisfied. So the teaching has to be given. To whom the teaching is to be given now? Are you giving a teaching to society child? Or are you teaching to biological child? Or are you giving to divine child? Whom is the teaching? There is spiritual teaching. For whom is the spiritual teaching? Society child, there is no teaching required. This teaching is for the divine child. The divine child, this chaos which is going on, it has forgotten that I am divine. Okay? It has to remember that I am divine. So the teaching is for the divine child. The biological child will die at the age of 70, 80, whatever the boy becomes old. The society child will continue in the form of your thoughts. Okay, you receive the thought from all the world society and you drop your thoughts into society. You keep on populating your thoughts, right? The biological child is also perpetuated. You produce two kids, one kid, to perpetuate your biological existence. The divine child doesn't require perpetuation. But divine child has forgotten that he is divine and he is cooperating with this society child and biological child. The memory is for the divine child. Remembrance or teaching is for the divine child. By whom is that teaching? The teaching for the divine child is from the divine father, Narayana Parabrahma, Sadashiva. And what is the teaching? What is the teaching? The teaching is Nanembudu. Nanalla.
Nanalla.
Ideha.
Ideha.
Manabuddhi.
Manabuddhi.
Nanalla.
Nanalla.
Sachidanandatma.
Sachidanandatma.
Shivananani.
Shivananani.
Shivoham.
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 I am not the body.
I am not the body.
I am not the mind.
I am not the mind.
I am not the intellect.
I am not the intellect.
I am pure consciousness.
I am pure consciousness.
Divine nature.
Divine nature.
Shwasurupi.
Shwasurupi.
This recollection will happen for the divine child. Because it is overpowered by the society child and the biological child. The teaching has to be given in a very authentic way. And who has to give the teaching? The teaching is given by Bhagavan himself, Narayana himself. So that's why teaching of spirituality originated from Sriman Narayana. So Sriman Narayana and Sadashiva. There are two streams of teaching originated in India. So this is a day we respect Vedavyasa Maharshi because he systematized teaching. Now where did the teaching come from? The teaching came from Sriman Narayana and Sadashiva. I'll tell you what is that. Narayana,
Narayana.
Samarambha,
Samarambha.
Vedavyasa,
Vedavyasa.
Shankara,
Shankara.
Madhyamam,
Madhyamam.
Asmadacharya Paryantam,
Asmadacharya Paryantam.
Madde,
Madde.
Guru Paramparam,
Guru Paramparam.
Sadashiva,
Sadashiva.
Samarambha,
Samarambha.
Shankaracharya,
Shankaracharya.
Madhyama,
Madhyama.
Asmadacharya,
Asmadacharya.
Paryantam,
Paryantam.
Vande,
Vande.
Guru Paramparam,
Guru Paramparam.
The teaching has to be given to the divine child. Who has to give the teaching? Only divine father can give the teaching. Only the father can tell the child that you are my child, you are me. So that's why the teaching originated from Sriman Narayana and Sadashiva. The two streams of teaching came. Okay? Jnana Parampara, the teaching of Jnana originated from Sriman Narayana, Vishnu, devatas, rishis and many masters took that teaching. Jnana, the clarity of who am I, this teaching came from Srimad Narayana. So then there is also a need for certain practices for us. Wisdom is jnana. The practices for life called yoga parampara originate from Sadashiva. Sadashiva, Shiva, many rishis and Shankara. So they give the teaching of yoga parampara. Yoga is set of practices. Jnana is set of wisdom. So there are two traditions. One Srimad Narayana started Jnana Parampara, and another tradition, Yoga Parampara, started Sadashiva. Narayana and Sadashiva are same. Okay? They are one and the same. They are given different name for the function which they have done. So this teaching has come to us from time immemorial. And during Mahabharata war, there was a possibility of the whole system getting destroyed, education system destroyed. That's why Sri Shankara put together a system of education. He took Vedas, Upanishads, and divided among his students. Each of them should take a certain teaching all the way to the next generation. So he established a teaching system through the masters. Without the masters, the teaching is not effective. So this became what we call as later day Guru Parampara, the system of teaching. Okay? You can imagine how difficult to put together a system of teaching. The primary school, middle school, there should be a system which generates these teachers, otherwise the teaching quality will not be there. Then Vedavyasa Maharshi understood that this teaching of Vedas is going to be difficult for many people, because over a period of time the education system is likely to collapse. People cannot understand Vedic teaching. That's why he introduced the teaching in the form of stories. The Vedic teaching has to be converted in the form of stories, and that conversion in the form of stories became what we call as Puranas. 18 Puranas are there, Devi, Vishnu, Shiva, Garuda. Okay? The idea is Kanda. All this, the teaching of Vedas has to reach the common man in the form of stories. And they should reach the common man in the form of sculpture, the statues, the vigrahas, the forms. So you have a form and you have a set of teaching in the form of stories. Just like in your place science experiment, science lab, your science experiment and a subject. You have to do something and then there's a subject. Like that, society requires something to look forward to, something to remember. That became the sculptures of the divine beings. And the teaching of Vedas became stories. Now see the beauty of this whole thing. Okay? The formal education system of Vedas was collapsed, cut through, got destroyed. But the informal education system through this teaching of Puranas, stories, not destroyed. Okay? See the wisdom of the sages. The stories will pass on from generation to generation without destruction. Whereas a formal education can collapse. But informal education can continue from generation to generation to generation. From father to son, son to grandchildren, grandparents to children. So even today, the spiritual knowledge, see if you look at any other culture, they have children are taught some education system. Go there, study this, your holy Bible, holy Quran, whatever is that. Where is the education system for us? But we leave that truth in the form of stories. Okay, the whole truth was converted into stories to pass through generation to generation. Tell me, anybody can design such an education system which will pass on from generation to generation without collapse. And nobody comes and teaches your grandmother what is Ramayana story, what is Shiva story. But Ramayana and Shiva story are taking this truth from the grandmother to grandchildren. Okay? This, go to the school system was destroyed. Still, the education of spirituality continued in the form of stories. And this robust system was designed by Vedirasa Maharshi. Seeing through the generations and generations, it will continue. Today, if you are able to still leave some of the culture, it is due to the system which was designed by Vedirasa Maharshi. One is system of teaching called Guru Parampara. Second thing is called system of syllabus. Syllabus is formal syllabus and informal syllabus. Formal syllabus is Vedas, Upanishads. Informal syllabus is stories. Entire thing was designed by Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. So that's why we are very thankful to Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi for all this teaching. The informal system of education continued, but formal system got collapsed because of the destruction of the education system by the invaders. But even during that period, many people, what they did, the learning became memorized. They started memory, it went into memory rather than when this thing was got destroyed, the written manuscripts are destroyed. Many people memorized the entire system, and through memory they passed on from generation to generation. Shruti. Okay. So the whole system became memory, because if you write it somewhere, you can destroy it. It gone from memory to memory, generation to generation. So if Vedas are 100%, today about 40% are surviving, not even more than 40%. So that 40% is thanks to many of the people who took a responsibility to memorize the entire thing and pass it on to next generation. So we are thankful to all the masters who passed on the wisdom from generation to generation. We are thankful to the people who preserved the knowledge in the form of memory. Okay? Today, every possible thing has been corrupted. You see the internet messages, WhatsApp messages. Any message can be distorted. Anything can be corrupted by human mind. But not a bit of Vedic knowledge cannot be corrupted. Because the Vedic knowledge has a way of chanting, way of memorizing. Even if you add a little bit noise there, it gets corrupted. Such a system was designed where the human mind cannot go and corrupt it. So we are thankful to Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi for Puranas, for putting in installing a system of Vedic education, installing a system of masters, and seeing through over millennia this education gets passed on. He put his only syllabus. The wisdom is only one. You are divine. Okay, that's all. The entire Vedic syllabus, there's not much to study. We don't have to get afraid that so much to study. There's so little to study. Very little to study. But the problem is, human mind comes from various angles. Okay. Loko bhinna ruchihi. Everybody wants different taste. That you can understand only when you go to a sari shop with your wife and your daughter. I never realized there are so many colors of shades are possible, and there's a liking and disliking also. So everything is ever preference, and everybody looks in a life in a different way. So to cater to this various tastes, the Indian system created whole lot of spiritual literature, whole lot. It's a supermarket. You pick up anything, you have a taste. For your taste, something is available. So this is what is contribution of our saints and sages. Okay? So typically I remember this Pani Puri shop. The Pani Puri shop doesn't work in America and other countries. Okay? There everything is ready-made. Everything has to be customized. Here, oh, you want Pani Puri? Some little bit more salt? Okay. Little bit more tikka, you put it. So, customization of religion was allowed only in India. Nowhere else in the world the customization of religion is allowed to for your taste. So, only country in
Well, religion can be customized. You can customize the dress and what is it? Anything else. Religion was customized for every individual in India. Truth was not customized. Religion was customized. There is a difference between the truth and religion. That the truth comes only from the wisdom. So people practiced many, many religions, and still they didn't kill each other, they didn't destroy each other, they loved and lived together because of the contribution of our rishis, the imbibed value of peace, love and harmony. The only country which taught the whole world ahimsa, non-violence, is India. Everywhere else in the world, violence is taught. Satya, dharma, okay, this was taught in India. It became part of the Indian culture. The truth was a part of the Indian culture. Religion was customized. Nowhere else in the world, okay, religion can be customized. You change a little bit in the religion, you'll be hit. Here, religion can be customized. Okay, whereas truth is not customized. Truth is satya, the truth. Okay, ahimsa, non-violence, peace, shanti, prema, these are basic things. This is called Sanatana Dharma. Sanatana Dharma took many forms and shapes and started flowing through everywhere. You can customize truth to your society. You are actually village. You go to the village, one temple, okay? Temple, some Amma will be there. Now, which Amma, which Prabhu, you can't find. That is, that Amma, Divine Mother, has customized to that village. So, the religion took many forms and shapes in India because our ancestors understood the worship can take many forms, but truth is one. So for passing on the truth, you need masters. And India has a fortune of so many spiritual masters coming time and again, teaching the real spiritual wisdom. I was in South Korea and I was coming out of a business meeting. There was a group of businessmen who came out of another business meeting. They asked me, are you Indian or Pakistani? I said, I'm Indian. Immediately the whole group bowed down to me. We offer our respect to man from India, the land of Buddha. See, for a man from India, it has nothing to do with Buddha. There is so much of respect in a remote place called South Korea. You go to any part of the world, scratch a little bit surface, you can find the Indian culture deep down. Philippines, I went. In Philippines, the constitution of Philippines starts with, we respect Manu, who gave us the constitution. Manu Chakravarti, Manu. Now India, we don't remember Manu. Okay? And you go to Bali Island, suddenly get down from the airport, a big Gadodgaja statue will be there. Okay? People in India don't know Gadodgaja. Bali Gadodgaja is living. Bali Varuna Devata is living. Okay, you go to any part of the world, scratch the surface, you start Indian culture. And this was the contribution of our rishis, our spiritual masters. Without violence, with peace and love, we taught the whole world the divinity. That's where India was called Bharata. Bharata means, Bha means wisdom, Rata means bliss. The people shining in the bliss of knowledge, Atmajnana, is called Bharata. The country where people were shining, there was a glow on the face of the people. There was a radiation on the face of the people because of knowledge of self, Atmajnana. So this was that as a understanding in our system. And it was a primary school education, not the adult education or old age education. It was the education at birth. And that education at birth was called Brahmachari Ashrama. In the schooling system, you learn Brahman, the absolute reality in the schooling system. That's why it's called Brahmachari. So the education system was very well developed to teach the spirituality. And that brought the peace, that brought the love, and that made the country prosper like anything in the world. Okay? The peace comes, when there is a peace, when there is a love, when there is harmony, the country makes a progress. India was a very prosperous country even till 17th century. So this was the contribution of rishis. Today, whatever you call science and technology,
algebra, okay, then astronomy, the distance between the earth and sun, Ayurveda, many of these were preserved by Vedavyasa Maharshi. So we are thankful to Vedavyasa Maharshi for the origins of science and preserving love and peace and harmony in society for many days to come. That was the contribution of Vedavyasa Maharshi. It is not really acknowledged in the real society because we have already, as a society, we have forgotten. But as a custom, we have kept the Guru Parampara to remember Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. Vyasaya,
Vyasaya,
Vishnu Rupaya,
Vishnu Rupaya,
Vishnu Rupaya,
Vishnu Rupaya,
Vyasave,
Vyasave.
So we offer our pranams to Vyasa Maharshi for his great contribution of spiritual education, which lasted for many, many thousand years. A system of education, a system of teachers, a system of formal and informal education. That's what is the contribution of Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. Another beauty of India is that the truth is to be discovered by each of us. So there is a lot of focus on self-discovery. Indian system is not based on belief. Indian system is not based on belief. So believe this truth, otherwise you will be, believe this, otherwise you are killed. That's not our culture. Discover the truth through inquiry. Find the truth. So whenever the truth disappeared from the society, the great many masters came who discovered the truth again and taught it to society, not as a following, but they taught. Discover the truth yourself. If I eat food, my hunger will go. But for your hunger to go, you have to eat the food. So never in Indian society there was a stress on following. Okay, there was a stress on discovering. We lost our traditional values and we started becoming followers. That's not system. Indian system of spirituality is inquire, question, and discover the truth in your heart. You live the truth. Don't follow the truth. You cannot follow the truth. Okay? You have to live the truth. And this teaching many masters gave. When the traditional values in India are collapsed, Bhagavan Buddha came. He taught the great truth of enlightenment and liberation to the whole world. If you see from this side, India, all the way up to Japan, the teaching of Buddha is preserved in many ways. He focused on nirvana, on liberation path. The truth was rediscovered every new generation by the masters. Masters like Buddha, they taught us the inner journey. Not only us, many people all over the world. Let us offer our respects to Bhagavan Buddha. Buddham,
Buddham
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami
Sangam,
Sangam
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami
Dharmam,
Dharmam
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami
Buddham,
Buddham
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami
Sangam,
Sangam
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami
Dharmam,
Dharmam
Sharanam,
Sharanam
Gacchami,
Gacchami.
So what Buddha taught lasted for many thousand years. Again it started getting distorted. Wrong understanding came. Then Bhagavan Shankara came. He took the truth. All the wrong understanding what was there, he removed it and presented the truth of Sanatana Dharma, so called teaching of Advaita or non-duality, which is the original teaching he brought out. Buddha taught Advaita in a very different way. Over a period of time, Buddhist teaching got the master generation to generation. Some of the understanding, wrong understanding starts creeping in. Shankara again brought out the truth. Shruti, Smriti, Puranana, Alayam, Karunalayam, Namami, Bhagavat Padam, Shankaram, Lokashankaram, Sri Shankaracharya brought out the essential teaching of non-duality. I am consciousness, I am Brahman. That truth he brought out, which was lost to our 8th generation. The religion doesn't get lost. Religion gets practiced in various ways. But the truth gets lost because the truth has to be discovered by each individual. Truth cannot be something which you can follow. Truth is your individual search. So Sri Shankaracharya gave that in 7th century. Then came the masters like Madhvacharya and Ramanujacharya. They gave the system of Dvaita and Vishishta Advaita. One greatness of the place where we are sitting in Karnataka. Karnataka is the only place where all the three masters established their dharma. Ramanujacharya, Shankaracharya, and Madhvacharya is the place where all the three masters established various centers here. Now, Dvaita, Advaita, and Vishishta Advaita, they are not opposing philosophical systems. They are not at all opposing philosophical systems. They are one whole system of teaching which is applicable to for us in different aspects of our life. So that is told by Sri Hanuman. Hanuman actually incidentally was born in Karnataka. Okay, Hampi. In Advaita Ramayana, there is a question to Hanuman. Who is Rama to you? Who is Rama to you? Hanuman says, when I open my eyes, Rama is my master. I am the servant. Dasoham. I am the servant of Rama. We have to live our life like servant of God. That is the teaching of Madhvacharya, who is incarnation of Hanuman. So when you interact with the world, when you live in the world, live as servants of God. How to live? It was taught by Sri Madhvacharya. That's called Dvaita. So don't live like a boss. Live like a servant. That's all. You have to live like a servant of God. Do service. Work towards Dharma. Perform your karma. Respect Lord. This was the teaching of Madhvacharya. How to live in the world. Sri Ramanujacharya taught Vishishta Advaita. I am related to God. Hanuman said, when I open my eyes, I am servant of God, Rama. When I close my eyes and meditate, I feel I am related to Rama. Rama is my bandhu, saka. So, Sri Ramanujacharya taught a state of meditation where you feel oneness with God. Then Hanuman says, when I enter into samadhi, there is no I, there is only Rama. Atma Rama. Atma Rama.
Atma Rama.
Ananda Ramana.
Ananda Ramana.
Achyuta Keshava.
Achyuta Keshava.
Hari Narayana.
Hari Narayana.
Hari Narayana.
Hari Narayana.
Hari Narayana.
Hari Narayana.
Narayana,
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 Narayana.
So in a state of samadhi, I am one with Rama. Actually no I, only Rama is there. That is called three states, Dvaita, Vishishta Dvaita and Advaita. all those three philosophies found a place in Karnataka. So we are in a country which is India, which is holy. We are in a place where holiest of holy places, where divine beings like Hanuman and three acharyas taught. So we offer our prayers, our respects to Sri Shankaracharya, Sri Madhvacharya, Sri Hanuman and Ramanujacharya on the occasion of Guru Purnima. There are many, many masters came. When the country was in trouble, came the Guru Govind Singh. He taught how to fight the war. The masters don't only teach spirituality, they teach the protection of dharma. But for Guru Govind Singh, but for Guru of Sri Shivaji Maharaj, Swami Rama, right? Samarth Ramadas. The India war would have been culturally destroyed. Sri Vidyaranya built the Hukka Empire. Vijayanagara Empire to Hukka. So the masters established Dharma with Jnana. Many, many masters have come. Actually, when Sri Shankara trained Naga Sadhus, you know that they are very, very ferocious. Very, very ferocious. They are naked. Britishers didn't go to the east of India because they were scared of Naga Sadhus. Sri Shankaracharya gave Naga Sadhus the responsibility of protection of Dharma in the eastern state. So Dharma and Jnana was the contribution of our masters. The many masters have come. When Dharma, well, because of the British Empire, we were struggling. Sri Ramakrishna Paramahansa came. He established Dharma, he taught Dharma, realized the truth of all religions and gave confidence to India, Indians that whatever we are believing is reality. He rejuvenated India. The freedom struggle, people say, it's because of some politicians. It is actually the force behind politicians. Guru Tattva. Avatar.
वरिष्ठाय
श्रीरामकृष्णाय ते नमः अवतार वरिष्ठाय श्रीरामकृष्णाय ते नमः. So we had a system of education. When the system of education collapsed, the Indian system was such that you can discover the truth and teach the truth. No other country in the world, no other system in the world can allow that. So this was the greatness of India. Then came Vivekananda, many of the masters. In India has the fortune of a system of living teaching in the form of formal teaching, an informal teaching in the form of stories, and formal teaching by masters. Any point of time in India, living spiritual masters appear time and again to teach the education, spiritual education. In the modern day, we have Amritanandamayi. Throughout the world, she has spread peace and love. We had Meher Baba, Aurobindo. If you ask how many masters have come in India, innumerable. This was the contribution of education system which was established by Vedavyasa Maharshi. Please understand. People give respect to the IIT today. Why? IIT has produced so many brilliant people because there was a system of education. India has produced so many great saints and masters because of the system of education which was established by Vedavyasa Maharshi. Time and again, brilliant person will come and rejuvenate the truth. All that contribution is due to Sri Vedavyasa Maharshi. On his honor, we are celebrating Guru Purnima today. And on this day, I offer my respects to so many masters.